A warm greetings, aspirants. Welcome again to the Hindu News Analysis brought to you by Shankar IAS Academy. So in today's discussion, we have chosen articles from two newspapers, that is from yesterday's newspaper as well as today's newspaper. So these are the list of news articles that we are about to discuss today. So in our discussion, we'll be having three editorials and we have four other current affair articles which are related with the static part and dealt in a holistic manner. So I would advise you to watch through the entire session without skipping in between. So without wasting much time, let us get into our discussion. Now for our next news discussion, let us take up this news article. So the news article here reports about the Tamil Nadu state government's process of notifying the identified water bodies as wetlands for the sake of conservation purposes. So according to this news article, it says that the district level wetland management committee, which was established by the Tamil Nadu State Wetlands Authority, they have started the process of notifying certain identified water bodies as wetlands, and they are doing this for conservational purposes. So on that line, in the first drive, around four lakes from Chennai have been identified, and these lakes are notified according to the Wetland Conservation and Management Rules 2017. And for those who don't know, see, this Wetland Conservation and Management Rules, it was notified by the Union Ministry of Environment for the purpose of decentralized management of wetlands. That is, this particular act, it empowers the state government to identify and also to notify wetlands within their territorial jurisdiction. And in addition to identifying and notifying, it also empowers them to take certain steps that are necessary to regulate the activities in the areas in and around the wetlands for the purpose of its conservation. See, this is actually a step in the right direction, because as we know, decentralization in any part of governance will help in better management. So this is the essence of this article here. Now, keeping these points aside, let us take this article about wetlands as an opportunity to brush up our knowledge about wetlands. So first of all, let us see what all comes under wetlands, or what is a wetland. See, according to the Ramsar Convention of the year 1971, wetlands are defined as an area in which water is the primary controlling factor in the surrounding environment, plants and animals. So in simple words, in wetlands, the environment, plant life and animal life, they are majorly determined by water. So, according to Ramsar Convention, wetland may include areas of marsh, fen, peatland or water, whether natural or artificial, permanent or temporary, with water that is static or flowing, fresh, brackish or salt, including areas of marine water whose depth at low tide does not exceed 6 meters. So this is how wetland is defined in Ramsar Convention. Now let us decode this definition, or I'll explain this definition to you in very simple layman terms. So according to the Ramsar Convention, a wetland may include both a natural or an artificial water body. That is, a natural lake like that of Kolleru Lake and even an artificial lake like that of Pong Dam Lake can be designated as a wetland under the Ramsar Convention. And not just that, the water body which is identified as a wetland can be both temporary as well as permanent. That is, the wetland need not be always covered by water throughout the year. Now say for example, when you take the Kyoladyo National Park, which is actually a Ramsar wetland, it becomes dry during drought season. So this shows that your wetland need not be filled with water throughout the year. Now the next condition is, in a wetland, the water can either be static or it can also have a flowing water. So that means both rivers and lakes can be designated as wetlands. And the final condition is that the water in the wetland can be fresh, it can be brackish or salt, and sometimes even marine areas can be designated as a wetland. But when you want to consider a marine area as a wetland, it should satisfy a condition, that is only those marine areas where the water depth does not exceed 6 meters during low tide could be established as wetlands. So by now we have an idea on wetlands. We know what are the various criteria that has to be satisfied for an area to be considered as a wetland. So now let us move on to see the major types of wetland. Always remember there are 6 major wetland types, and they are man-made wetlands, estuarine wetlands, lacustrine wetlands, riverine wetlands, palustrine wetlands, and finally the man-made wetlands. So when I say marine wetlands, title itself signifies that it has to do something with sea. So these marine wetlands, it includes coastal lagoons and coral reefs. And when you take the estuarine wetlands, it includes the deltas, the tidal marshes, and also the mangrove swamps. And coming to the lacustrine wetlands, it generally includes lakes, and the wetlands along rivers and streams will come under the category of riverine wetlands. And then when you take wetlands along marshes, swamps, and bogs, they are classified as palustrine wetlands. And the last but not the least, that is the man-made wetlands, will include even the fish and shrimp ponds, the farm ponds, irrigated agricultural land, the salt ponds, the reservoirs, the gravel pits, sewage farms, and even canals. So these are the 6 major broad types of wetlands that are identified. Now, having discussed the definition, the types, and also the classification of wetlands according to Ramsar Convention, now let us move on to see the importance of wetlands, or in other words, let's now see why these wetlands have to be conserved. See, the Convention of Biological Diversity lists the following as the importance of wetlands. Now, before going into the following points, I wanted to share with you an important information. See, the reason for me to mention about this Convention of Biological Diversity here is that in your mains answer, if at all you get a question regarding the importance of wetlands, instead of writing your own points, it is always good if you are mentioning any valid source, because doing that will give legitimacy to your answer, and it will also helps you to get more marks, which will be beneficial in the longer run. So coming back to the importance of wetlands, see, firstly, wetlands perform various water related environmental services, say like that of regulating water quantity, then groundwater recharge, and also it contributes to the regulation of floods and the impacts of storm. And apart from these, it also helps in erosion control. So all these ecosystem services improve water security, including security from natural hazards and also climate change adaptation. So this is one importance why we need to conserve the wetlands. Now, secondly, wetlands are one of the most productive habitats of the world. That is, with their rich nutrient cycling mechanism, these wetlands, they offer a very good species diversity in plants and animals. Now, the third importance of wetlands is that these wetlands are a major habitat for world's water birds and also for migratory birds. So this is because these wetlands, they provide for the birds a good and nutritious feeding and breeding ground. And the next importance is that wetlands are an important source of food. Now, say for example, let's take a well-managed rice paddy systems. Now, generally in such a well-managed rice paddy system, not only the rice is produced, but then it also co-benefits from rice-associated biodiversity, say like providing habitat for some fishes and crustaceans like crabs. And when you take inland wetlands, they are actually an important source of fish production, especially in India. And the final importance is that wetlands also have a high recreational, historical, scientific and also cultural values, and they also support recreational activities, say like that of bird watching, then photography and also recreational fishing. So it is for these things also the wetlands needs to be conserved. So these are some of the importance of wetlands according to the Convention of Biological Diversity. So to conclude the discussion, see, in the segment we discussed about the wetlands conservation and management rules of 2017. We saw the official definition of wetlands, and we also saw what are all the water bodies that could be recognized as a wetland under the Ramsar Convention, and we also learnt about the types of wetlands and also the need to give importance to such environmental habitat. So with this, let us conclude our discussion and we will move on to the next news article. Now our next news discussion is going to be based on this editorial article. See, this editorial, it aims to address how a planned transition in India's energy generation capabilities will address both India's energy security needs as well as the environmental concern without causing too much burden on the consumers. So this is the ultimate idea based on which this particular editorial is built. And the editorial also highlights how this planned transition will actually help India to achieve the Sustainable Development Goal 7.0, which is to ensure the access to affordable, reliable, sustainable as well as modern energy for all. Now, before going into the editorial, I want to clarify an information with you. See, this particular editorial is a bit technical, but still it gives us insightful ideas about how a blatant focus on renewable mode of power production is not advisable and affordable. So this particular editorial takes a rational view about how India's energy generation mix should be. So therefore, I advise the aspirants to read this particular editorial after our discussion here, just to have an understanding on how you can structure your mains answer and on how you can take the flow of your answer. Because this particular editorial has got a great introduction and even the content of the article has got a nice flow. And when you look at the conclusion part, the editorial says about the benefits that could be attained when this particular plan which we are about to learn is implemented. So please go through this article, since it not only helps you in enriching your answer but also gives you an idea of how to frame and standard mains answer. Now, without wasting any more time, let us get into our discussion. The syllabus covered by this editorial is highlighted below for your reference. So first of all, what is energy security? See, energy security ensures that there is an uninterrupted supply of energy, that too at an affordable price. So this energy supply should also be reliable as well as it should be accessible to all people without any differences. So when you take India, see, if India wants to become a superpower, then it must definitely ensure energy security to its citizens. See, at present, India actually faces two major hurdles when it comes to ensuring energy security for all. So the first hurdle is the massive population, because as we know, the population of India is quite high. So supplying energy to its massive population is in itself a huge task for India. Now, apart from this, there is also another hurdle. So the second hurdle faced by India is to be an environmentally conscious country and to contribute to world efforts to climate security. So on that line, India should definitely augment its power production capacity without compromising on the environment. So first, let us see the role of thermal power plants in India's march towards an energy secure future. So thanks to the Electricity Act of 2003, because this act paved way for the installation of coal-fired thermal power plant generation capacity
in India to get doubled from 94 gigawatts to 192 gigawatts between March 2011 and 2017. See, this particular sharp increase in the installed capacity has in fact enabled the government to increase the per capita electricity consumption by 37%, while at the same time reducing the peak demand deficit from 9.8%, which was there in 2010-11, to 1.6% in the year 2016-17. Now, here you should know this concept of peak demand. See, this peak demand here means in an electricity power grid, the power demand will not always be constant. In the sense, the power demand is dynamic and it varies constantly. So, peak demand is the highest electricity demand that occurs in a power grid. So, for a tropical country like India, the peak demand usually occurs in the evening. So, this is how India's energy demand graph will look like. So, as you can see here, it is clearly visible that the peak demand falls around 6 p.m. So, here the editorial says that energy deficit during the peak demand fell from 9.8%, which was there in the year 2010-11, to around 1.6% in the year 2016-17. And a lot of contribution towards this was made by the Electricity Act of 2003. So, though this is a significant achievement, still India has got a long way to achieve or to ensure the energy security. Now, I'm saying this because India's per capita energy consumption is 1200 kilowatt per capita, which is around one third of the world average per capita electricity consumption. See, the world average per capita electricity consumption is 3200 kilowatt per hour per capita. See, remember this fact, India is rich in coal reserves. And even the geopolitical situation around India doesn't allow it to have ready access to piped natural gas. So, this is one of the major reasons why most of the thermal plants in India are coal powered. Make note of this, the thermal power plant in India contributes to around 71% of the total electricity that is generated in India. So that means thermal power plants do actually play an important role in making India energy secure. So by now we have a basic understanding about the Electricity Act of 2003, and we also saw on what is meant by peak demand, and we also saw the important role played by coal reserves and thermal power plants in India. So now let us see the part which is played by the renewable energy. Now see here, the editorial mainly talks about the variable renewable energy. Now see, this term variable renewable energy, as the name itself says, produce energy intermittently instead of on demand. So, variable renewable energies will include wind, solar, and also tidal. So, let's take the example of solar energy. We already saw that in India, the peak demand will usually happen in the evening. But when you closely analyze, during that time, that is during the evening, the power production from solar energy will stop to exist. So, this implies that the power production capability could not be altered based on the energy demand. So, this is one of the major disadvantages of all the variable renewable energy, because we cannot have them all the time. Now, see, as of March 2021, the installed capacity of this variable renewable energy accounted for around 24% of the total installed capacity. But then in the case of power production, it contributed only 10% of the total. So to focus on this variable renewable energy, the government gave huge subsidies to the sector, and thus the installed capacity of this variable renewable energy rapidly increased. But then at the same time, there was no corresponding increase in the consumer power demand. So this has of course indirectly led to the low utilization of thermal power plants as well. And when you take the current level of this variable renewable energy in the national power grid, it is found to be increasing the cost of power procurement for DISCOMs, which in turn is leading to the tariff increases for electricity consumers. And thus, it all paves way for making the power unaffordable, which in turn is dampening the power demand increase. So this shows that the India's power transition plan must be pragmatic. That is, it must reduce the carbon dioxide production, but at the same time, it must not make power unaffordable. So to achieve this particular editorial is proposing the following plan about which we are going to discuss now. So first of all, according to this editorial, the 211 thermal power plants with installed capacity amounting to 36 gigawatts must be retired, because these power plants are old and they are also inefficient. So the resulting shortfall caused by it in the electricity generation can be made up by increasing the utilization of existing high efficiency, low emission thermal power plants that are currently underutilized to accommodate the variable renewable energy. See, there are also 47 new government-owned thermal power plants that are in the advanced stage of construction. So these power plants, when commissioned, could also help to bridge the 36 gigawatts when the old and inefficient plants are retired. So in addition to this, also know that the Nuclear Power Corporation of India Limited is also constructing around 11 nuclear power plants with a total generation capacity of around 8,700 megawatts that has got the capability to supply 24/7 power without any carbon dioxide emission. So with the implementation of this transition plan, the total installed capacity of the thermal power plants will be increasing from the current level of 209 gigawatts as on September 2021 to around 220 gigawatts by the financial year 2029-30, and that too even after retiring 211 inefficient and obsolete thermal power plants that are more than 25 years old. And also know that the combined thermal and nuclear capacity of around 235 gigawatts can meet the base load requirement during the evening peak in 2029-30. See, already we saw what is meant by peak load, right? So there is also a related term called as base load. See, base load is nothing but 80% of the peak load. So when discussing the variable renewable energy, we say that most of the variable renewable energy could meet the evening peak load experienced in India. So to address this, huge investment should be made in the battery technology. But when the transition plan suggested by the editorial is implemented, this investment in batteries is not necessary. So this in turn will make energy more affordable to the customer, and also optimal utilization of existing as well as under construction high efficiency, low emission thermal power plants with lower technical minimums also facilitates this variable renewable energy integration. When this energy transition plan is implemented, India's power generation from the thermal power plants is expected to reduce from the financial year 2021 level of 71% to just 57% of the total energy, which is projected to be generated by the power utilities during the financial year 2029-30. And more importantly, the share of the inefficient thermal power plants with obsolete technology in the total thermal power plants generation capacity will also reduce from the financial year 2018-19 level of 46% to just 4%. So what happens is, due to this significant reduction in the old and inefficient power generation from thermal power plants, the total carbon dioxide emissions from the power sectors will be going down by around 57 metric tons, even as coal-fired electricity generation is projected to increase by 21% in the year 2029-30. And this will actually help us in achieving energy security. So the new high efficiency, low emission thermal power plants will have high efficiency electrostatic precipitators which are attached to them, and this will help them in bringing down the particulate matter emission. And the additional benefits apart from this includes the lower emission of sulfur dioxide and also nitrogen oxides. And due to the higher efficiency, the coal consumption and the water consumption in the power plants will also be reduced. So this plan will in short ensure energy security, and at the same time it will also ensure environmental security. And this plan ultimately demonstrates India's commitment to the climate change mitigation by optimizing the use of our land, our coal, our water and even our financial resources with indigenous technology. So these are the important points this editorial has given to us. So with these discussed points in mind, let us conclude this editorial discussion and move on to see what the next news article has got to tell us. Now look at this news article. The news article here talks about the amendments which were proposed to the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972, which is shortly known as the WPA 1972. See, this Wildlife Protection Act was initially framed in the year 1972, and the reason for framing it was that there was a rapid decline of India's wild animals as well as birds. So on that line, some became extinct and some were even subjected to other dangers like poaching. But then the existing laws were found to be insufficient or outdated, because such laws, they controlled hunting, but then they did not emphasize on other factors that were also leading to the decline of wildlife, say like that of trade in wildlife. So there was a need to enhance the protection to wildlife. So in this backdrop, the WPA or the Wildlife Protection Act was enacted with the objective of providing the protection to such wild animals, birds and plants whose numbers were decreasing. And it was also done to ensure the ecological and the environmental security of the country. See, as we know, the WPA or the Wildlife Protection Act protects wildlife by listing them under schedules. And remember, there are 6 schedules in the Act, and these schedules, they provide different levels of protection to various species. Now, say for example, hunting and commercial exploitation of wild animals, which are included in various schedules, is prohibited, along with certain exceptions. Additionally, any offense which is committed in respect of these scheduled species also attracts punishment. So with this background, let us look into the proposed amendments. So by now we have a basic understanding about Wildlife Protection Act and its basic framework, and we also saw as to how or the reason why this particular act was enacted. So now let us move on to see the amendments which were proposed to this act. See, the amendments to this act will be brought by a proposed act called the Wildlife Protection Amendment Act of 2021, and the central government has asked the various state governments and the union territories to submit their views or their comments on the amendments. See, there are 2 major criticisms surrounding this amendment act. So the first criticism is that the proposed amendments document was not kept in the public domain for public scrutiny, but rather this has been kept confidential. See, generally any changes to any legislation are kept in public domain and government, and they will be inviting comments or objections for it from the public, environmentalist or other stakeholders. But then now this form has been violated or it has not been followed. So this is one criticism. Now coming to the second criticism. Secondly, the proposed amendments were not published in vernacular languages. So let us see whether the judiciary intervenes and invites public opinion in this regard. Now since the proposed amendments document is not available in public domain, we are going to see the proposed amendments as mentioned in the article given here. So firstly, the amendment proposes to reduce the number of schedules in the Wildlife Protection Act. See, we saw that as of now, there are 6 schedules which are providing various level of protection to the wildlife. So here the critic feels that this is actually an unnecessary move. Now secondly, the amendment proposes to establish an authority called the Standing Committee of State Board for Wildlife. Now this committee is said to consist of a vice chairperson, a member secretary and not more than 10 members. And it is said that this particular committee will be having similar powers to that of the Standing Committee of National Board for Wildlife. So according to the critics, this move will weaken the state wildlife board because of 2 major reasons. Now the first reason for saying so is because certain responsibilities of the State Board for Wildlife might be transferred to its Standing Committee. See, currently the State Board for Wildlife has got important responsibilities, say like that of the selection and the management of areas which are to be declared as protected areas. Now secondly, the committee will also delay the decisions of the State Board for Wildlife, and there is also a fear that the meeting of this State Board will not be held regularly like that of the National Board. And this is because even though this National Board is chaired by the Prime Minister, it also has a standing committee and is not met for the last 7 years. So because of that, there is also a fear that even the State Board will end up in a similar way. Now coming to the third amendment. Thirdly, this amendment proposes to insert a new section called as 42A into the Act, and this particular section is regarding the surrender of wild animals and products. So according to this particular proposed section, any article or any animal which has surrendered shall become the property of the state government. So these are the important provisions which are proposed in this amendment. So by now we have a broad understanding of the WPA Act and its framework, its origin, and we also have a fair knowledge on the amendments which is proposed recently. So now let's move on to the next news discussion. Now look at this op-ed article. See, this op-ed article is regarding a discussion about the implications of the sale of Air India. And this is basically a conversation between few important significant persons. And if you remember, the government introduced a bold new disinvestment policy in this year's budget. And this policy envisions an absolute minimum presence of government-owned firms, even in strategic sectors. And if you had noticed, in this financial year alone, the government is pursuing the sale of its whole ownership in public sector companies like BPCL, Shipping Corporation of India, IDBI Bank, 2 other public sector banks, and even in one general insurance business. So considering India's recent record of disinvestment, earlier this month also, the Tata Group emerged as the winning bidder for Air India, which is a debt-laden national carrier. So this is the content or the basic underlying theme of this op-ed article. So without wasting much time, let us get into our discussion. The syllabus covered by this op-ed is highlighted below for your reference. So first of all, what is privatization? See, privatization can be defined as the process through which a piece of property or a business passes from government ownership to private ownership. So to put it in simple words, privatization is the process in which the transfer of ownership or property or even business takes place from the government to the private sector. So that means once a property or a business is sold, the government will stop to be the owner of that particular entity or business. So in this process, what actually happens is that a publicly traded company will be taken over by a few people, or in layman term, by a private sector. And the stock of that company will no longer be traded in the stock market. And the general public will also be barred from holding stake in such a company. And also remember this. See, government-owned businesses can be converted into private businesses in two major ways. That is, the transfer of ownership from government to the private can be done in two ways. So the first way is through the withdrawal of the government from the ownership and from the management of public sector companies. Now coming to the second way, see, apart from the withdrawal of the government from the ownership and the management of public sector companies, this transfer of ownership can also be done through the outright sale of public sector companies. See, apart from this, there is also a very important concept called disinvestment, about which we are going to discuss now. See, privatization of the public sector undertakings by the selling of parts of the equity of these public sector undertakings to the private sector is known as disinvestment. See, as we know, the public sector undertakings are the basic wealth of the nation. So, promoting such ownership of the central public sector enterprises would actually ensure that this wealth remains in the hands of the people. So the key difference between the privatization and disinvestment is that in privatization, the government will sell more than 50% of its shareholdings. Whereas when you take disinvestment, the shareholdings less than 50% is sold by the government. So now we know what is privatization, we know what is disinvestment, and we also know what is the difference between privatization and disinvestment. So now let us move on to see why the government promote privatization and disinvestment. So usually the reasoning for this transfer is that the privately owned businesses are subjected to market discipline, because of which they are expected to be more efficient. So a similar argument for privatization is that the privately owned businesses are in fact more valuable, and they are also more well maintained when compared to that of the government owned businesses. Coming to this context, see, the main purpose of the sale is to improve the financial discipline and also to facilitate modernization. And as per the title, it generally helps the governments to save money and to increase the efficiency of the public sector undertaking, where private companies can move goods quicker as well as more efficiently. And apart from this, as you know, the increased inflow of FDI also improves the financial strength of the company. And on that line, privatization actually helps us by providing a strong base for the inflow of the foreign direct investment. So this is a broad overview of the underlying concept of this editorial. Now let's move on to see the important points that are mentioned here in a very crisp manner. See, as I said already, earlier this month, the Tata Group, they emerged as the winning bidder for Air India. And if you know, Air India is a debt-laden national carrier, and now it has got privatized. So according to this article, this successful privatization of Air India is actually viewed to be as a watershed moment in Indian history. And On that line, many more loss-making units that are constantly draining taxpayers can also be found strategic purchasers by deploying the right sweeteners. So this is the ultimate essence of this OPIT. So to put it in simple layman words, see, instead of draining the taxpayers' money by owing loss-making units, it is going to be more helpful if the ownership is transferred to a private enterprise, which will ultimately result in the restoration of economic stability. And having said that, through this sale of Air India, we can actually expect that the Tata Group's acquisition of ownership will also set a precedent for privatization in India. And with that, let us close this OPIT discussion. And with the learned concepts in mind, let's move on to the next news discussion. Now let us take up this article for our discussion. So this article reports about an incident of unauthorized export of the genetically modified rice from India to Europe. And this incident is currently under investigation by the center. So this is the reason why the news article has gained headlines. Now before getting further into the discussion, let us brush up our basics regarding the genetically modified organism, and we'll also have a quick understanding of the conventional transgenic technology. So the first question is, what is a genetically modified organism? See, according to the WHO or the World Health Organization, genetically modified organisms are those organisms in which the genetic material, that is the DNA, has been altered in a way that does not occur naturally by mating or by natural recombination. And when I say genetically modified organism, it is not just limited to only plants or only animals, but rather a genetically modified organism can be either a plant or an animal or even microorganisms as well. See, one point that you should note here is that this genetic recombination not only occurs artificially, but then it also occurs naturally as well. So naturally, this genetic recombination occurs during the meiosis type of cell division that takes place between the prophase 1 and metaphase 1 by a process called crossover. So you just remember this term, that even naturally genetic recombination occurs, and it occurs during the process of crossing over. So when you take this crossing over process, this is actually a very slow and also a random process, and this does not necessarily always lead to advantageous traits. So in the case of genetically modified organisms, what we do is we use modern biotechnology in order to select individual genes that are to be transferred from one organism into another, and also between non-related species. So this, on the other hand, is actually a fast and a targeted process, and such foods which are produced from or by using these genetically modified organisms are often referred to as genetically modified foods. So some examples of such genetically modified foods can be the BT cotton, or even the Dara mustard hybrid 11, which was developed by the Delhi University. So by now we know what is a genetically modified organism, and we also know what is a genetically modified crop or genetically modified foods. So now let us see some of the positives and negatives that are associated with such genetically modified organisms or genetically modified foods. See, one of the major objectives for developing such plants which are based on genetically modified organisms is to improve the crop protection. See, when you take the genetically modified crops which are currently on the market, they are mainly aimed at an increased level of crop protection through the introduction of resistance against those plant diseases which are caused by insects or virus, or through increased tolerance towards herbicides. Now see, for example, the resistance against insects, they are achieved by incorporating into the plant, say like that of cotton or brinjal, the gene for toxin production from the bacterium called Bacillus thuringiensis. And this is the reason why they're called BT cotton or BT brinjal, because of the Bacillus thuringiensis, which is incorporated into this plant. So what happens is, this toxin is currently used as a conventional insecticide in agriculture, and also this toxin is actually safe for human consumption. So what happens is, such genetically modified crops that inherently produce this toxin, they have been shown to require lower quantities of insecticides in specific situations. So in India, this, as we all know, BT cotton was the very first variety of genetically modified crop that was approved for commercialization or sale. And Monsanto, which is a US-based agrochemical company, what they did is they actually released two varieties of Bolgard, namely Bolgard 1 in the year 2002 and Bolgard 2 in the year 2006. And the main reason behind it was to provide immunity against pink bollworm. So if you have noticed, in the 2021 prelims, there was actually a question regarding this Bolgard 1 and 2. So once you get done with this discussion, please try to attempt that question, because after this discussion, I'm pretty sure you'll be having a fair understanding of the issue. Now, keeping that aside, let's come back. See, the other advantages of such genetically modified crops includes the reduction of spoilage, that is, the shelf life of these crops can be increased. And apart from this, some of the other advantages of the genetically modified crops include the increase of the nutrient profile of the crop, say like that in the case of golden rice, and also the introducing of drought resistance in crops, and also making the crops salt resistant. Now here, one thing you should keep in mind. See, the application of this genetically modifying technology is not just limited to crops. But say for example, actually scientists at present, they are working with genetically modified mice in order to develop male contraceptive pills. So while learning, you please pay attention to such informations, because in prelims, they might cover those areas where there are possibility of having less awareness or understanding. So in prelims, be careful, because UPSC might ask some lesser known advantages and also the applications of the GM technology, like the one which I have mentioned earlier, because such questions can actually increase our probability of guessing the wrong answer. See, most of the times we cover an issue comprehensively, but then you can also do some research on your part and you try to take note of all the wide ranging applications of a particular concept which we are learning, and you try to make an holistic note for yourself in such a way that you need not refer to any sources further. Now coming back, by now we have a fair understanding of the pros or the positives that are associated with this GM technology. Now let's move on to see the negatives that are related to the GM technology. So when you look at the cons of GM technology, actually, the cons of this technology can be grouped under three heads, like the environmental concern, the economic concern, and also the ethical concern, which are surrounding this genetically modified crops or genetically modified organisms. Now, first comes the environmental concern. See, the environmental concern of the GM technology or the GM crops includes the adverse effect of these GM crops on the species diversity. Now, sometimes this GM technology could also result in the transfer of genes from one crop to another, and this result in the creation of super weeds, which will be immune to common control methods. Apart from this, the genetically modified microbes can at times turn into super bugs by gaining resistance to common antibiotics. So these are some of the common environmental concerns that are associated with the genetically modified organisms. Now coming to the next part, which is the economic concern. See, developing the genetically modified organisms are a time and resource consuming process. So thus, it doesn't make financial sense to actually invest in the GM technology considering the alternatives. And then there is also the issue of farmers losing the control to few multinational companies. And finally, another economic concern is that many GM crops are not providing the promised yield, and the yield which they are providing is also declining with each passing year, like in the case of BT Cotton in India. Now, coming to the last part. See, as I said earlier, there is also an ethical concern regarding the genetically modified organisms, because some feel that these GM crops are in violation of natural organisms' intrinsic values by mixing among species. So, by now, we have covered the basics of GM technology, and we have also covered some of the pros and cons associated with this technology. So, with this understanding, now let us once again get back to the article which was in news today. See, the scientists from the Indian Agricultural Research Institute are currently working on the technology that would actually help us in genetically modifying plants without using the controversial transgenic technology. Now, let me explain this to you for a better understanding. See, here the scientists are actually altering the genetic makeup of the plant for getting desired traits. But the main point to note here is that they are trying to do this without introducing a foreign gene. Now, let's once again go back to the BT cotton. See, when you take the BT cotton, it is a genetically modified crop and it is also a transgenic crop. So, I am calling this genetically modified because its genome is altered. Similarly, I call it a transgenic crop because it has a foreign gene incorporated into it. And that foreign gene is the Bacillus thuringiensis, because of which it has got the name BT cotton. Now, coming back, see here, as per the news article, the scientist at the Indian Agricultural Research Institute, they are actually trying to develop a high yielding and resilient rice variety by using gene editing technology, but they are trying to do it without introducing a foreign gene. So that means this high yielding rice variety is genetically modified, but it is not a transgenic crop because it does not have a foreign gene into it. So, to conclude, just have this point in mind that all transgenic organisms are genetically modified because their gene makeup is altered. But then, it is not always necessary that all genetically modified organisms are transgenic. That is, it is not always necessary that for all the genetically modified organisms to have a foreign gene into them. So, I think you can understand the concept here. Now, moving on further. See, the gene editing tool which is used here, as mentioned in the article, is the site-directed nuclease, shortly called as SDN 1 and 2. And this technology offers more precision and it also offers more efficiency while using the genome editing technology like CRISPR. So, the issue here is that the scientific community, they are of the view that this type of genetic modification, which is done without the introduction of a foreign gene, must be placed under the conventional breeding techniques. So, when I say conventional breeding techniques, it includes those techniques like cross-pollination, hybrid breeding, self-fertilization, etc. See, and the reason for the scientist to advise to keep this genetic modification technology, to keep this genetic modification technology under the conventional breeding is that when classified under conventional breeding, the technology will attract lesser scrutiny by the genetic engineering appraisal committee. So, for those who have not heard about this genetic engineering appraisal committee, see, they are the apex body who decide on the approval for the research and commercialization of transgenic organisms. Coming back, the final take regarding this has been produced before the GAAC and it's been pending for 2 years. Until now, there's no decision been taken. So, this is the ultimate crux of the news article mentioned here. So, to conclude, in this statement, we have covered many aspects of GM technology and we also saw about a new technology that involves gene editing without the use of conventional transgenic technology. So, I hope that you guys have got a fair understanding of the issue discussed today. So, now with these takeaway points in mind, let us wind up this discussion and move on to the next news article. Now, let us take up this news article. So, this news article reports about our Prime Minister's visit to Glasgow on the 31st of this month to attend the United Nations Climate Change Conference or COP26. And the news article is also brought to light. In that summit, the One World, One Solar, One Grid initiative is expected to be launched, where at least 120 world leaders have confirmed their attendance. So this is the basic crux of the article here. So in this context, let us briefly see about the Conference of Parties or the COP, COP, which is in limelight at today's article. See, the Conference of Parties is the supreme decision-making body of the Convention of the United Nations Climate Change Conference, and all states that are parties to the convention are represented at the COP, in which they will review the implementation of the convention and any other legal instruments which this Conference of Parties adopt. Now, apart from this, they also make decisions which are necessary to promote the effective implementation of the convention, which includes both institutional as well as administrative arrangements. Have in mind, one of the most important tasks or a key task for this Conference of Parties is to review the national communications and the emission inventories which are submitted by the parties. So based on this information, the Conference of Parties, they assess the effects of the measures which are taken by the parties and also the progress that is made in achieving the ultimate objective or the ultimate aim of the convention. Remember, this Conference of Parties, they meet every year unless the parties decide otherwise. Now, coming to the COP26, remember, the United Kingdom will be hosting the 26th United Nations Climate Change Conference of the Parties, which is shortly known as COP26, and this is going to happen in Glasgow on the 31st of October this year, and it will span till the 12th of November 2021. See, the conference will also be a crucial opportunity to achieve important transformational change in global climate policy and action. As we know, climate change impacts are now affecting each and every region on the earth. And on that line, this COP26 comes against a theme of extensive, rapid and intensifying climate change consequences. And furthermore, this COP26 also takes place against the backdrop of the COVID-19 pandemic, with the urgent need to rebuild a secure future for the current and future generations. I will very briefly give you the goals of this United Nations Climate Change Conference or the COP26. See, this COP26 or the United Nations Climate Change Conference has got four major goals, and they are to secure global net zero by mid-century and to keep 1.5 degrees within reach. And the second goal is to adapt to protect communities and natural habitats. And then the third is to mobilize finance. And then the final goal is to work together to deliver the best possible results. And with this, let us wind up this news discussion and move on to the next part of our Hindu news analysis. Now let us take up this editorial for our next discussion. So this editorial basically talks about the recent Moscow format dialogue that was held on the 20th of this month. And the editorial goes on to talk about on how India and regional powers should engage in a dialogue with the Talibans in order to ensure the stability in the Afghanistan region and also to make sure that the Taliban government uphold the rights of the Afghani citizens. So this is the ultimate essence of this editorial article. So come, let us move into our discussion. The syllabus covered by this editorial is displayed below, so kindly go through it. Now, before going into the article, let us briefly get to know about the history of the Talibans so far. See, it all started in the year 1978 when Afghanistan witnessed a USSR-backed revolution. And three persons are important in this issue. One is Noor Muhammad Taraki, and the next one is Afizullah Amin, and another person is Babrak Karmal. So what happened is, these three persons, they initiated a revolution and they established the Democratic Republic of Afghanistan through that revolution. And then following that, a pro-Soviet government was established, and the communist government, they tried to implement the land reforms. But then it was executed very poorly, and this led to massive rural poverty. So what happened is, naturally, people, they started to resort to civil disobedience, and they tried to take control of the city of Herat. So therefore, in order to bring down the people's movement, the government, they started engaging in aerial bombing of its very own citizens in the city of Herat, and this resulted in a death toll of up to 25,000 people, according to some estimates. And this incident resulted in a nationwide armed rebellion, and these rebels were called the Mujahideen, whose initial aim was anti-communism and not Islamism. Okay, so the Mujahideen people, they evolved with an initial aim of anti-communism only, and at that time they did not have much intense objectives related to Islamism. And these people, that is the Mujahideens, they were backed by the United States, Pakistan, and also Saudi Arabia. And then moving on further, in the year 1979, the Soviet army, they started to invade Afghanistan in the name of protecting the communist government. See, the key advantage of Mujahideens was that they lack unity, and they also lack a central command. Because without a central command, the Soviets were not able to bring the Mujahideen to the negotiation table. So recognizing their disadvantageous position, and also recognizing that they couldn't do much as expected, this Soviet troops, they withdrew themselves from Afghanistan in the year 1989. So obviously this resulted in a Mujahideen victory. So that means in 1989, the Soviet troops, they came out of Afghanistan. See, after this Soviet withdrawal, Afghanistan fell into a civil war. And this civil war lasted from 1989 to 1996. And then while this was happening, another important development also took place. And that is the Talibans. See, the word Taliban refers to students in Pashto language, and these Talibans, they emerged in the early 1990s in the parts of northern Pakistan. So being a newly formed Islamic militia, these Taliban, they rose to power on promises of peace. That is, they came to power by proclaiming that they give more importance to peace, and also by proclaiming that they will bring peace soon to the region. And as I told you, at that time the situation there was very deteriorating. So most Afghans, they were exhausted by the years of drought, famine, and war. So what happened, being in such a deteriorating situation, they instantly gave support to the Taliban for upholding traditional Islamic values. And the Talibans also kept their promise, and on that line, they started cracking down on crime. And this resulted in them getting more and more support eventually from the Afghan people. But then they have one shortcoming, that is, the Talibans tried to curtail the education and employment of women, and even today this is one of the major controversy surrounding the Taliban's reign. See, according to Talibans, they required women to be fully veiled, and they are also not allowed outside alone. And know that these Talibans, they stayed in power for approximately 5 years, that is from 1996 to 2001, when the United States invaded Afghanistan. And on that line, as we all are aware, recently the United States, under the Joe Biden administration, they finally decided to withdraw themselves from Afghanistan. And this once again gave the Talibans the chance to come to power in the year 2021. So this is a very brief history of the modern Afghanistan. So with this background, let us now get into the editorial discussion. See, initially India actually did not recognize the Taliban government. But then this state was changed with the signing of the joint statement in Moscow. Because through that signing, India actually signaled the world that it has accepted the new reality that is happening in Afghanistan. And in fact, this is a very decisive shift in India's approach to Afghanistan. See, earlier when the Taliban was closing in on Kabul, India established contacts with the Taliban office in Doha, Qatar. But then this physical meeting is the very first time that Indian officials are directly engaging with the Afghanistan delegation. See, recently in the United Nations General Assembly, our Indian Prime Minister spoke about the Afghan situation. And while talking about it, he mentioned that the world countries have got the responsibility to help the women, children and minorities of Afghanistan. And they have also got the responsibility to help in Afghanistan's developmental needs. So this is now put into motion since the Afghan spokesperson later claimed that India promised to send aid to Afghanistan. So this is also a welcome move on India's side. So now let us see what interest does India have in establishing a stable Afghanistan government. So come, let us go over those points one by one. See, the first and foremost is that India has made a lot of investments which are worth billions in Afghanistan. For example, we have helped Afghanistan to build the Afghanistan parliament in the year 2015. And then in 2016, we helped them build the Salma Dam. And apart from that, we have also invested in many infrastructure projects. So it is very straight that in order to safeguard India's investment, we have no other option than to have a stable Afghanistan. Now, next on line is India's concern regarding the Taliban making Afghanistan a safe haven for terrorist groups. See, when Taliban was previously in power, which was between the year 1996 to 2001, India had experienced an increase in violation, especially in the Jammu and Kashmir, due to the activity of the Lashkar-e-Taiba and the Jaish-e-Mohammed. See, the both the terms which are used now, that is the Lashkar-e-Taiba and the Jaish-e-Mohammed, are organization who are known to have some bases in Afghanistan. So, though the new Taliban regime has promised that its territory would not be used by terrorist organizations, still India has got the responsibility and also the need to ensure that the government keep their promise. And then finally, by engaging with Talibans, the India must also make sure that the Talibans doesn't act as Pakistan's satellite. So in order to ensure whether all the above mentioned concerns of India are addressed, we have an urgent need to ensure that Afghanistan has got a stable government. So by now we have a broad understanding of the history of Afghanistan, the history of Taliban's, their emergence, and we also saw on how Afghanistan is important to India and why there is a need for us to pave way for a stable government in Afghanistan. So now let us move on to discuss the editorial, which talks on how India must approach the Taliban government. See, the economy of Afghanistan is actually at shambles because after the Taliban took over, the IMF, they withheld around $450 million that it was supposed to give to Afghanistan. And then the United States, they froze $9 billion of international reserves of the Afghanistan Central Bank. So therefore, for the Taliban, in order to keep the economy of Afghanistan afloat, it really needs some regional help. So it is a right time for India to get into this, because India should make use of this advantage. See, India bilaterally does not enjoy much clout with regards to the Taliban. So in order to engage, India should actually follow the regional policy rather than the bilateral one. So the Moscow format, in which around 10 countries, which includes India, China, Pakistan, Iran, Russia and Central Asian powers participated, is actually a good way for India to engage with the Taliban. And even the neighboring countries of Afghanistan also want a stable government so that the terrorist activity doesn't spill over to their own territory. So on that line, we must engage with all the regional powers who stand to benefit from a stable Afghanistan in order to negotiate with the Taliban. So through this collective economic and political clout, India has got an opportunity to mount the pressure on the Taliban to ensure that an inclusive government is established, the concerns of the various minorities are addressed, and the right, and also whether the rights of the women and children are ensured. So finally, on that line, India should also ensure whether the Taliban keep their promises. So to conclude, here in this segment, we actually saw the brief history of Afghanistan in order to gain perspective. And then we looked into the Moscow format dialogue that took place recently. And then we also saw what are all the India's interest in Afghanistan. And then we finally concluded by seeing how India must engage with the Taliban's in future. See, if you had been constantly following the newspaper and also our Indian news analysis, you will be definitely knowing that Afghanistan is in news often. And in fact, we have covered Afghanistan in most of our discussions, and we have had a multi-dimensional approach towards the issue, wherein we addressed or we discussed the various aspects of India-Afghanistan relationship. So what actually you can do today is, instead of taking notes of the entire session, you try to add the points that we discussed today in your notes along with the aspects that we have discussed earlier, because it not only helps you to have a broad understanding over the issue, but it will also help you in enriching your notes, which would be of a great help to you in the last minute revision during the mains preparation. And by doing that, you can also gain a holistic understanding of the issue with wide-ranging aspects while revising it. So with this, let us conclude this editorial discussion and move on to the next part of our Hindu news analysis. Now look at this question related to the WPA Act. See, with reference to the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972, consider the following statements. Statement 1, its objective is to control poaching, smuggling and illegal trade in wildlife. Statement 2, as per the Act, wildlife includes only the animals and birds. And statement 3, it has 6 schedules providing different level of protection to the wildlife. So we need to find the correct answer here. So when you take the first statement, as we discussed earlier, its objective is to control the poaching, smuggling and also the illegal trade in wildlife. So that makes the first statement correct. Now coming to the second statement, which says that as per the Act, wildlife includes only the animals and the birds, is incorrect. Now this is because as per the Act, wildlife includes any animal, aquatic or land vegetation, which forms part of any habitat. So that means it includes all animals, birds and even plants. And furthermore, a separate schedule called as Schedule 6 is also there, which protects plants by listing them as specified plants. So that makes the second statement incorrect. Now coming to the third statement, it says that this particular act has got 6 schedules providing different levels of protection to the wildlife. So this statement again is a right statement as of now. But then this statement is subjected to change if the amendment is passed. Because if the amendment is passed, then the number of schedules may change. So as of now, this statement is right. So since we need to find only the correct statements here, the right option will be option B, which is 1 and 3 only. Now look at this question about wetlands. Consider the following statements regarding wetlands, conservation and management rules 2017. So the first statement is that it provides for the creation of Central Wetland Regulatory Authority. The second statement says the identification of wetlands is done by the center. And the third statement is that the Central Wetland Regulatory Authority performs the role of advisory body. And then the fourth statement says that the 2017 rules included water bodies such as backwaters, lagoons, creeks and estuaries into the definition of wetlands. So here again we need to find the correct statement. So when you take the first statement, this particular statement is incorrect because the Central Wetland Regulatory was created by the 2010 rules and the 2017 rules replaced the Central Water Regulatory Authority with the National Water Committee. So that means the first statement is incorrect. Now coming to the second statement. So this statement too is incorrect because as we saw in the discussion, it is the state government which will be identifying the water bodies for conservation and not the center. So second statement too is incorrect. Now coming to the third statement. So this statement again falls out to be wrong. And you can even guess this by reading the first statement itself. Because the Central Water Regulatory Body is replaced by the National Water Committee. And this body performs the role of advisory body. So this statement too is incorrect. So the first, second and third statement, they all are incorrect. Now coming to the fourth statement. This statement again is incorrect because actually the 2017 rules, they removed the water bodies like backwaters, lagoons, creeks and estuaries from the definition and they did not include it as mentioned in the article here. See, according to the Ramsar, these water bodies, they come under wetlands, but according to Wetlands Conservation and Management Rules 2017, they cannot be notified as wetlands by the states. So since none of the options given here are right, the correct answer here will be option D, that is none of the above. Now look at this prelims practice question. The question is that which of the following are the application of DNA recombinant technology? And we have five statements given here. So the first statement is development of vaccines. The second statement is bioengineered crops with good biomass and biofuel production capability. The third statement is the synthesis of glucose from sucrose. The fourth statement is the monitoring degradation of garbage and industrial waste. And the fifth statement is converting plants performing C3 cycle to plants performing C4 cycle. See, all the options that are given here are in fact the applications of DNA recombinant technology. And since all the statements given here are correct, the correct option here will be option D, which is 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. Apart from this, I advise you to make it a point to search for other lesser known applications of genome editing as well, and you try to update them in your study notes because there are higher possibility for other applications to be asked in statement based question, especially in the prelims. So it is always better to be fully prepared. Now moving on to the next question, which is about the conference of parties or the COP26. So the question is, which of the following is or are the goals of the COP26 of the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change? So the first statement is to secure global net zero by mid-century and to keep 1.5 degrees within reach. The second statement is to adapt to protect communities and natural habitats. And then the third statement is to mobilize finance. See, in our discussion itself, I have clearly mentioned the four main goals of this COP26, and all the three goals that are given here as three statements are part of the four goals. So that means all the statements given here are correct. And since they are correct, the correct answer here will be option D, that is 1, 2 and 3. See, you can't predict UPSC's trend in asking questions, because this is evident even with this year's question paper, because we had questions from sports as well after a very long time. So whatever you're learning, you try to make a note of it and you try to go through them even at the last moment. See, UPSC doesn't demand our knowledge on everything, but it demands us to know something about everything. So on that line, it is always good to be prepared for the adverse and the most difficult situations. And that preparation can come only if we are consistent in what we are doing and if we are dedicated towards what we do on a daily basis.
The list of mains questions are here. So aspirants, please write your answers and post them in the comment section for us to review it. So with this, we have come to the end of today's Indo News analysis. And if you had liked my video, then please don't forget to like, comment and share. And do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates regarding UPSC Civil Services Preparation.